staying for the last talk of the session. Today I'm going to provide some preliminary results from our tagging study that we started in Lake Ontario on Chinook salmon. I'd like to acknowledge my collaborators. Jesse Leacock is our Sea Grant Extension Associate of the project, and Christopher Pearl is an old buddy from way back who's actually a marine tagging expert. And then Lars Rudston, my mentor at Cornell. And our two charter captains, Captain Ernie Lantan from Fish Doctor Charters, and Kit Mamone from Rochester Sport Fishing. And of course, Sea Grant for funding this project. So just to start off, I wanted to be kind of continuing Brian Weidel's talk this morning. Goes in a lot of the details. I'm just going to do a quick overview of just the relationship of Chinook and alewife in Lake Ontario. Then I'm going to go to the research questions and information needs that we have for Chinook salmon. Talk a little bit about pop-off satellite archival tags, which is what I used in this study. And go into specifics on the tagging and retrieval methods, and then show you some data from last summer. So as Brian said this morning, we really should enjoy this resource. This is from last June. Just the capacity of Lake Ontario to produce 20 to 30 pound Chinook salmon is something, you know, people drive a lifetime to be able to do. Currently, there's many charter boat operators that can help you, as well as they put perks in like the LOC derbies. I don't know if you know about that, but the prize winning Chinook for two out of the three derbies in the summer is a prize of $20,000. So that's basically making a community of fishermen kind of competing with each other, enriching bait shops and, you know, check-in stations. And it's a very popular event. This year it was kind of toned down a bit by the lake level. You know, people just thought it was maybe not safe to go out on Lake Ontario. So then there's set of charter boat captains who are really entrepreneurs. They're lone gunmen pretty much. They have their own boats. They get sponsorship sometimes, but really working in inclement weather, really enthusiastic about the system, and really interested. And so we really tried to seek a partnership between scientists and the users of the lake. And then don't forget the river population. So you have Salmon River Hatchery, all the fish lined up to come in. And then we met some of the guide services on the river because they actually found some of our tags in Salmon River. So this is a huge commercial benefit to local communities. And going to Weidel's point, back in, this is a picture in Chicago in 1967, and I actually saw a report that caused the alewife explosion. Fish kills throughout many cities in the Midwest, as well as Lake Ontario. And they even had congressional hearings about the problem. One solution that they came up with was to stock predators, so including Chinook, but also coho and steelhead from mostly Pacific populations. So with the theme of this conference, Forage and the Food Web, looking at alewife, look at some of the spring trawl data that Brian talked about. In this case, there's a yearling and adult alewife, and these are just pointing out the intense variability of alewife populations, as well as the general decrease in alewife, but it's a very important thing to track in connection with Chinook populations. Got a problem here. It's here. And in Lake Huron, back in 2004, we had kind of a lower food collapse in the lake. And this is a plot of Chinook landings. So intense decrease after that. Much due to an alewife impact from the decrease in the lower food web. So this is something we don't want to happen in Lake Ontario and other Great Lakes. And it leads to deciding between how much to stock and how much to harvest. There are also UMNAP surveys in the summer, and this is from 2013, which is an intensive survey. It's getting nearshore to offshore in different months, and it's showing that ALWAFE are primarily in the epigenetic. And then there are also acoustic surveys that show some really neat diurnal migrations of ALWAFE. So during the night, you have much dispersed population in the epilimnion, but during the day, you get to see schools, which I found out in Charbonneau Captain is called bait balls in the sonar. So we see this in zooplankton migrate to the surface waters at night. We see mice that come up from the deep to the metalimnion. So, and then we see ALWAFE do this kind of migration. It kind of makes sense that Chinook might have something like that as well. So there are many ways to monitor Chinook, but it's very difficult to use hydroacoustics or netting to catch them. So that's why we rely on charter boat captains. There is several angler surveys, which Channel Entry does, and you get often valuable samples so you can look at the growth rates of fish. And there's also fin clip studies by Mike Conradin, which look at the amount of natural reproduction as well as the general dispersal. Some of my key research questions here were, the first one is pretty obvious because all the charter boat captains know that this is a vital importance. It's how important is water temperature? And then are there day-night changes in distribution? And then how do chinook respond to horizontal gradients? And then how far do they roam? So I'm going to be talking about using pop-off satellite archival tags. So they have the means to pop off the fish using either pyrotechnics, like a little bit of black powder, or a copper release system. And then they have antennas which allow data to be transmitted to a satellite, and that includes position as well as data. And then they are archival, so they have sensors all over the packages, and then their temperature, light, depth, magnetic field, and acceleration. Can somebody get me some water, please? I'm tired. I'm not crying like that a few weeks ago. Trips over the summer. It was in mid-July and early August, which is kind of not the optimal time to tag chinooks because you do have to drag them up from a deep depth and then go through the procedure, which is not an operation, but just a needle going through just below the base of the dorsal fin and leading a monofilament tether. And this is what the tether and the tag looks like there. And sometimes we tow them for recovery. The two sites that we tagged were Braddock Bay and then Oswego. We had two trips. And then what happened is we programmed them to release 30, 60, or 90 days from time of tagging. All five of the wildlife tags did report to the satellite, and three were physically retrieved, whereas none of the Desert Star tags reported, but two were returned by fishermen. The two I'm going to talk about today are one that showed up in Coburg, Ontario, on August 27th. It was initially tagged July 13th. And then we also have this one that was, a tag was found October 6th, and it was tagged on the same day, July 13th. So it went much shorter distance, but a longer time period. We think it actually entered the river at September 6th, but never really let go of the fish. So we actually retrieved the full tether and not none of the tag actually released. We did have another recovery from a fisherman, but that one, the battery was compromised in the middle, so I'm not going to be showing that. What the wildlife computer portal has a really nice user-friendly portal, which actually sends a signal to your smartphone and tells you you have a tag that popped up. So, and then you can watch it drift across the lake. This one has actually drifted for a month. Unfortunately, we did not retrieve this one. But others hit the shore. This is the one that was in Coburg. You can see the spread of these points are actually considerable. Sometimes it even ended up on the downtown pier. We think that it was on the fish in this. This is an urban environment, but it was actually in this Coburg Creek, which I had never heard of as a spawning creek. And then there's a water release where the tag actually was found right here by me and a friend. And then this is another example of a spread of points provided at Stony Point, and it was basically in somebody's lake house beach. Got another dish. So here's some of the data from the covert tag, just to emphasize this is 45 days of data taken every second, starting July 13th in Oswego, ending in August 27th. And what you're looking at is the depth, and then the temperature is in color. And so the first thing that comes out at you is that the temperature of most of the field is very close to what's known for salmon preferences, you know, 13 to 15 degrees Celsius. But there are considerable shallow forays up into the epilimnion, and then also deep dives, even as deep as 100 meters. This was an interesting feature, very cool water at the surface, so that kind of put on some, and then basically the fish went deeper and then came back to stage. This is the last point in the Coburg Creek, actually.
Started.
Oh,
that was my bad, sorry.
I must be hitting something. Look at a histogram of the entire data set. Again, we see this preference for 13 degrees Celsius with a very narrow and unimodal pattern. And then for depth, we see several modes. And that's due to the changing hydrography. You actually have the fish settling into four separate modes, but kind of an average of 14.7 meters. This corresponds to the base of the thermocline in eastern Lake Ontario. If we look at very closely at this time series, we see these are 30-minute windows, and this is one example of a upward foray, which is only taking 2 minutes, and again, the color is temperature. And then you also have features like this downward dive. This is the big one that goes down 100 meters. It goes straight down and then steadily climbs up for 20 minutes, but then quickly regains its preferred situation. Now, when we were wondering about that shallow pool water, I looked at some of the satellite imagery. And so we're seeing Coburg is located where the arrow is. We can see that the feature we're seeing is August 6th through 11th. Now, look at August 3rd to August 6th, a very large upwelling event happened. And this is the same day that you might have heard Rudy's Lake Stand Drive-In in Oswego had like stones come up on the benches and surround it. So this was a huge wind event that led to a major pooling event on the northern shore of Lake Ontario. And this lasted for quite a few days, but by the 13th it had largely relaxed to the western. So it really explains well that feature we see in that. Now, a couple weeks later, we're out on the Lake Guardian, which is the EPA vessel, and we collected several profiles from